Bueno, gracias por venir a la clase en Colorado. Hi, so I'm Carol, and then this is our class at University of Colorado. Can you see us okay?
Yeah, we can see you guys fine. We can hear you good.
Great.
And you can hear and see us okay?
Yeah.
Okay, excellent.
Is that okay, or is it better with the light on or off?
I think on's a little better.
Okay, that's fine. Let me see if I can make your image larger. Not sure how to do that.
There should be a bar on the left of the like vertical line. You can grab that and drag it.
No. Okay. Okay, not that. Oh my goodness. Bottom left. Oh my gosh.
It's a vertical line that separates the video and the rest of the screen.
Oh no. It goes nowhere. Oh no, I just made you smaller when I was trying to make you larger. I did. Oh my gosh. Bottom left. Nope, that's right back. Sorry. Oh my goodness. Now I've lost your video altogether. Trying to make it better. Restore layout. Let's see. Oh, you guys, come on. Okay. All right, we'll just leave it like that. I can't make it any larger, but anyway.
So you can see us all right?
We can see you in the small screen.
Can you also see the PowerPoint presentation that we loaded up with the map of Columbia on it?
Yes. Yeah. Here we go. It's also... Okay, sorry. Here we go. All right, we're just going to have to do it like that for now, I think.
Okay.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you guys so much for coming to our class. We're going to be brewing some coca tea while you all are talking, just in solidarity, wishing that we were there actually with you.
Hi, my name is Isaac, and I will be just for today for the presentation here. We have two organizations present. I represent the Fellowship of Reconciliation, and I believe that you can't see here. And then Austin, he's from the Witness for Peace, along with Jesse, who is right there. And we are collaborating to do these what we're calling webinars with various classes around the United States. So today, I'm just going to really briefly talk about what is Fellowship for Reconciliation and then what is Witness for Peace. And then we're introducing Maria, and then Maria will begin to talk. And we'll have time for questions at the end, and also we have some suggestions for you all to want to be continuing to be involved with these issues, what she's talking about in the state, where you can check you for that. So the Fellowship of Reconciliation is, we are a nonviolent pacifist organization. We use the tool of accompaniment here in Colombia, which basically is using a combination of political work and physical presence to bring security to threatened communities and organizations. And the communities and organizations that accompany are working in Colombia to demilitarize their lives and lands. And after this class, we'll be sending an email to you all with the basics of our website if you're interested in looking more into volunteering with FOR or doing a delegation or something like that. Okay.
And I'm with Witness for Peace, and we're also a United States-based organization, and we do monitoring of U.S. policies and practices by the government, as well as corporations operating over here, and we raise awareness of these issues in the states to create a ground movement to change these policies stateside. This is our speaker, Matia Victoria, and she has she's been working with indigenous groups and women's rights organizations for the last 25 years. She's currently working with what is called Association Minga, which is probably one of the most prominent and most respected human rights organizations in the whole country. She's a program coordinator for the Cauca region, which is a department that's becoming, the war on drugs is shifting to that region now. So it's becoming one of the hardest hit. But she started in Nariño and around Putumayo and has been covering Latin Colombia since the start.
Would you like us to introduce ourselves too?
Sure, yeah.
Okay, why don't you go around and you can hear it. Just, I'm going to ask the students to give their first name and what state they're from in the U.S. Anything else? Probably good. So just so you can have a sense for who's here. Okay.
I'm Sarah. I'm from Colorado.
I'm Amy. I'm also from Colorado.
I'm Robin. I'm also from Colorado.
I'm Lindsay. I'm from Washington.
I'm Maria, and I'm from Washington.
I'm from Illinois.
I'm Christina. I'm from Colorado.
Hi, I'm Kimby. I'm from Colorado.
I'm Emma, and I'm from Colorado.
I'm Dave. I'm from Georgia.
I'm Jesse. I'm from Pennsylvania.
I'm Bobby. I'm from Maryland.
I'm Leslie. I'm from Oregon.
Josh. I'm from Connecticut.
I'm Galen, and I'm from Colorado.
I'm Deanna, and I'm from California.
I'm Wesley, and I'm from Colorado.
Did you hear them okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Great. Great. I'm going to go back to your PowerPoint here. Okay.
Okay. Yeah, we can go ahead and start when you're ready.
Okay. Go ahead. Are you all ready?
Yes, we are.
We're ready.
Hola, buenos días.
Hello and good morning.
Bueno, como le dice Austin, mi nombre es María Victoria. Trabajo con la Asociación MIGA, una organización de derechos humanos aquí en Colombia.
Cool. Well, as Austin said, my name is María Victoria and I work with Asociación MIGA, which is a human rights organization here in Colombia.
Para empezar, es importante diferenciar el cultivo y uso tradicional de la coca y la producción de cocaína, que, como todos sabemos, es ilícita.
Well, to start, I'd like to clarify, it's very important to clarify that there's a difference between the cultivation and traditional use of coca and the production of cocaine, as we all know, is illegal.
En Colombia, Perú y Bolivia, en la zona andino-amazónica, el cultivo tradicional, cultivo y uso tradicional de la coca es en el orden religioso, curativo y alimenticio.
So in Colombia, Peru and Bolivia, which is where the Andes are, in the zone where there's the indigenous and the Amazonian people, the traditional use of coca has been has religious, and medicinal and personal uses.
En su uso medicinal, creo que ustedes ya lo conocen, es un analgésico, es antibiótico, es antiinflamatorio.
So, as you guys may know, and she's putting up a little box. This is coca tea, which you guys already have. But the medicinal use, you can use it as an analgesic or an antibiotic or an anti-inflammatory medicine.
Bueno, y en su uso religioso y mágico se emplean las hojas tostadas con otras plantas sagradas. La coca es una planta sagrada que se utiliza con otras plantas sagradas que conectan a los seres humanos, los indígenas, con la madre tierra.
So the coca has many religious uses, where the leaves will be toasted and then with other leaves of sacred plants. The coca leaf is one of those sacred plants. It is used to connect human beings, the indigenous people, with the Mother Earth.
Y en su uso como alimento, permite que las comunidades que viven en los Andes a grandes alturas tengan una fuente de proteína y de energía extra para soportar largas jornadas de trabajo.
Sustenance, it allows communities to live like high up in the mountains in the Andes to use it as an extra source of protein and energy where they have to go like travel long days.
En 1971, en la Universidad de Harvard se realizó un estudio acerca de las propiedades de la coca. Y encontramos que es una fuente rica en calcio y potasio y con mucho valor nutricional.
So there was a 1971 Harvard study that showed that the properties of coca have they're very rich in calcium and potassium.
Pero es a partir de 1960 que empieza el proceso químico que desvirtúa totalmente el uso tradicional y ancestral de la hoja de la coca que sintetiza la cocaína.
So, starting in 1960, they began the chemical process in which the coca was disvirtued. It was removed from its traditional and ancestral use to produce coca, cocaine.
Este desconocimiento, esta desvirtuación desde el mundo occidental de la tradición y el valor de la coca conlleva muchos impactos tanto en su cultivo como en su erradicación para las comunidades indígenas.
So the disconnect or the not knowing by the Western world of the traditional value and use of coca brought policies that favored the eradication of cultivations of coca here.
Estos impactos son en tres aspectos. Uno sobre la gobernabilidad y autonomía política.
And there's about three main aspects about impact on people here. And one was on governability and political autonomy.
Porque la coacción, el uso de la fuerza sobre las comunidades, tanto para la siembra como para la erradicación, afecta directamente, son factores de violencia externos a las comunidades.
So the use of force against the communities for planting it as well as for eradicating it affects the people there, and it has there's a very, very big violent factor.
Tanto en su producción como en la posterior erradicación se militarizan los territorios tanto por fuerzas armadas del gobierno como por actores armados ilegales.
So it's very violent because of the militarized zones where there's production as well as eradication in the future. And it's militarized not just by legal government forces like the police and the army, but also by illegal armed actors.
Y esta combinación de actores armados legales e ilegales en los territorios producen permanentes combates, bombardeos, siembra de minas antipersonas, desplazamiento forzado de las comunidades, en algunos casos confinamiento, es decir, que no pueden salir de su territorio.
The combination of legal and illegal armed actors within these territories produces a state of permanent combat. It causes a lot of death, a lot of forced displacement, and also confinement because people aren't able to leave their communities because it's not safe.
Así como también el asesinato y estigmatización de autoridades y líderes indígenas.
It also produces a lot more killings and stigmatization of community leaders and indigenous peoples.
En los impactos socioculturales, entonces tenemos como personas extrañas a las comunidades, militares o los erradicadores o campesinos, rompen la vida cultural y social de las comunidades indígenas.
So there's also many sociocultural impacts where we have strangers coming into the territories due to the militarization, and this is includes military officials, the eradicators, and campesinos. And with all these people coming in, it starts to break the social fabric of these indigenous communities.
Y de otra parte, ya el procesamiento de la coca, que, bueno, el producto final es la cocaína, introduce unos patrones sociales y económicos desconocidos para las comunidades indígenas, y con esto lo que se han llamado los vicios de afuera, prostitución, alcoholismo, drogadicción, que no son propios de las comunidades indígenas, pero que sí llegan con este nuevo modelo social y económico que forzadamente se introduce en las comunidades.
Well, so also the processing of coca into cocaine and within these communities brings very negative social and cultural impacts on these places. So it changes them because it brings what they call like outside vices or defects, like outside defects, which include prostitution, alcoholism, and drug addiction, which are not usually part of these communities before. These things are introduced, but they come when economic production is forced on their communities.
Y finalmente, los impactos más fuertes están sobre, además de estar sobre las personas, están sobre el territorio y este como base de sustento de las comunidades indígenas. Entonces, de una parte, todo el proceso de la coca para la producción de cocaína tiene un alto grado contaminante sobre el suelo y sobre las fuentes de agua. De otra parte, con la práctica de la fumigación, se ha denunciado de diferentes formas el deterioro a la salud humana.
Well, one of the strongest impacts that it has would be on the territories, which is like the base of self-sustenance in these communities. So the processing of cocaine, they use a lot of chemicals, including like gasoline and different types of peroxides, But those all go into the earth and into the water, which contaminates that place and makes it dangerous for people to grow their own crops or to drink the water that comes out there.
And we've also been denouncing that the fumigations that take place here have been noted to have been noted to deteriorate human health.
Y así como la producción de coca para la cocaína produce deforestación, contaminación del suelo, del agua, del aire, y un gran uso de plaguicidas, herbicidas, abonos químicos, la fumigación, la dispersión aérea, no solamente es sobre los cultivos de coca, sino sobre los cultivos de pan coger de las comunidades.
The production of coca for cocaine produces deforestation that contaminates the air and the land. There are also herbicides and chemical fertilizers and aerial fumigations that don't only like eradicate or take out the coca crops, but they also go over all of the all the foodstuffs, all the their agricultural production that they use for themselves.
En el 2008, la Corte Constitucional de Colombia promulgó el auto 04, en el que se reconoce que en Colombia hay 35 pueblos indígenas en riesgo de extinción.
En 2008, la Constitutional Court of Colombia came out, like promulgated what's called Auto 4, which recognized that there are 35 indigenous pueblos communities that are on the verge of extinction.
Y uno de los factores de riesgo de extinción de estos 35 pueblos indígenas es la militarización de los diferentes actores armados y el conflicto por el control de las rutas del cultivo o por la extinción de los cultivos de coca para la producción de cocaína.
And that should have been non-indigenous communities, but indigenous people, like different tribes. And one of the biggest factors for bringing about their extinction would be the militarization of different groups of armed actors who are vying for control of trafficking routes or cultivation in territories.
Y bueno, finalmente, todos estos impactos agravan las condiciones de vida de las comunidades indígenas, impiden el desarrollo de sus planes de vida y en general afectan radical y gravemente su forma de relacionarse, de ver el mundo, de ser y de hacer. O sea, toda su integralidad como ser humano.
And so finally, the impact of the coca crops and cocaine production has severe or severely degrades the quality of life of the indigenous peoples. It affects their plans for development on their own, and it also radically affects the way that they
are able to see the world, to be, and to do how they choose.
Cool. Do you guys have any questions?
You want to take a pause for questions now? Are you going to talk about some of the work that you're doing, Maria, and some of maybe your thoughts for what needs to happen?
¿Quieres saber un poco más del trabajo que haces y de lo que piensas que necesita pasar?
A ver, es importante mencionar que muchas comunidades campesinas e indígenas se han involucrado en grandes extensiones de cultivo de coca para la producción de cocaína, porque en Colombia desde hace muchos años no hay una política agraria que permita que los cultivos tradicionales realmente sirvan para el sustento de las comunidades de campesinos e indígenas.
So it's important to mention that there are many indigenous communities that, yeah, indigenous and for like peasant farming communities
that do take part in the production of cocaine, but this is because for many years in Colombia there has not been any sort of agricultural support on behalf of the government that supports their cultivations of their traditional crops, which would serve to sustain their communities.
Hay algo interesante, es que la próxima semana en la ciudad de Cartagena, aquí en Colombia, se va a realizar la Cumbre de las Américas. Y una de las propuestas que hay desde los movimientos sociales es cómo trabajar la despenalización de la coca, cómo trabajar con el pueblo norteamericano que se transforme la lucha contra las drogas, porque no son los campesinos, no son los indígenas los que se enriquecen con esta producción, sino que son los que manejan las rutas y el comercio.
Also important to note that next week in Cartagena, which is a city in northern Colombia, the Summit of the Americas is going to take place. And that's a summit in which every head of state from the Western Hemisphere comes together every 3 years to talk about issues. And one of the proposals from social organizations is to talk about depenalization of drugs. And so they would be working with the United States government, which is the biggest resistor of that policy, to change policy, because right now it has much more effect, like indigenous peoples and poor peasant farmers who grow it, instead of the people who manage trafficking routes and distribution.
Bueno, trabajo hace más o menos unos 25 años con organizaciones de mujeres y con comunidades indígenas en el suroccidente de Colombia.
So I have to explain a little more about what she does. So she's worked for over 25 years with women and indigenous organizations. And right now she's working in the southwest of Colombia.
Con las organizaciones indígenas, principalmente con la CIN, hemos venido trabajando el fortalecimiento del gobierno propio y la autonomía como pueblo nativo de este país.
So regarding indigenous organizations, she works mainly with the ASIN, which is Carol, last speaker that you had was Rafael Cuecui, but he is part of the ASIN. It's one of the most organized and strongest indigenous people's networks in Colombia. So she works with them to strengthen their self-government and their autonomy to restore the
Y de otra parte, también hemos venido trabajando
la resistencia pacífica, la resistencia sin armas, porque la guerra contra las drogas y contra la insurgencia lo que ha provocado es el desplazamiento masivo de comunidades indígenas, afros y campesinas de sus territorios.
Now they're probably working to strengthen pacifist resistance. Yeah, or peaceful resistance. So the war on drugs and the counterinsurgency strategy have produced massive displacement of indigenous, Afro-Colombian, and peasant farming communities.
Y el trabajo por la resistencia pacífica es permanentemente visibilizar que las comunidades no están involucradas y no se quieren involucrar con los actores armados. Pero como propietarios y dueños ancestrales de sus territorios, quieren permanecer y que todos sus hijos y sus generaciones puedan vivir en estos territorios sin ser involucrados con la guerra y de acuerdo con su propio pensamiento de cultura, de autonomía, de desarrollo.
Another part of peaceful resistance would be to permanently visibilize that communities do not want to get or keep them from becoming involved with armed actors so they can hold on to their land and traditions. Because they want to, make permanent the, for future generations so that they can live on their own land, stay out of the war, and keep their autonomy and their own form of development and way of life. But yeah, any other questions?
I have a question. Who do you think that has an impact on the indigenous people of Colombia? The Colombian government with their policies of fumigation and I guess the extermination of the coca plant, or the cartels who are displacing people and doing what they're doing in the cocaine production.
Sorry,
we're having trouble hearing. Would you be able to repeat
that? Carol, could you move close? Someone just supposed to repeat it. Thank you. Yeah, so I just wanted to repeat it.
Thank you.
Who's having more of an impact on the indigenous people in Colombia? The Colombian government with their policies of fumigation and all the stuff that's happening on their side of the war on drugs, or the cocaine producers who are displacing indigenous people and in their production of cocaine.
¿Cuál entidad tiene un impacto más en las comunidades? Entonces sería el gobierno con
Colombia.
Sí, el gobierno de Colombia con sus políticas de fumigación y erradicación, o los que producen la coca, porque van desplazando la gente.
Okay.
Una pregunta difícil. Porque de una parte los carteles de la droga, los narcotraficantes hacen alianzas con actores armados ilegales para la producción y comercialización de la coca.
So one part would be that the cartels, the narco traffickers, make alliances with illegal armed groups for production and distribution.
Y de otra parte, los agentes estatales, las fuerzas militares gubernamentales, cuando entran a los territorios a hacer la erradicación forzada, también cometen múltiples violaciones de derechos humanos.
And on the another part, with, on the other hand, you have state forces and government actors who come into communities and they eradicate or fumigate the crops, and they come up with, or they generate lots of human rights violations. And I would say that the fumigation itself caused displacement.
Y el encuentro de estos actores armados ilegales, narcotráfico y hasta actores armados legales es, se traduce en bombardeos, en confinamiento, en minas antipersonas que afectan directamente a las comunidades, tanto campesinas como indígenas y afros. Por ejemplo, en Putumayo, en este momento, se habla de más o menos 40 municipios, perdón, 40 veredas de 3 municipios del Bajo Putumayo. Con campos minados, lo que significa comunidades confinadas, que no tienen acceso a alimentos, a medicinas, que no pueden nadie salir ni entrar en sus territorios.
Mira, ¿cómo combina? Minas antipersonas. So, if you have the combination of illegal armed actors as well as legal ones, and together they produce all these violations, so bombardments, confinement to communities that directly affect the indigenous peasant farming and Afro-Colombian peoples. So there's an example. In Putumayo, which is in the south and where Plan Colombia was launched, there are 40 villages in 3 municipalities that have minefields around their communities. So they can't like leave their anti-personnel mines. If they leave, they run at risk of blowing themselves up. They don't have access to outside of where they are to help or to food.
Those mines would produce in the U.S. of course.
I actually would have a question I'd want to ask her as well. That's all right. Oh, sorry. Do you have a question? You go first.
Yeah, go ahead.
No, go ahead.
I was just going to add, I'll ask her how you guys, students in Colorado, are connected. How are you connected to what's going on in Putumayo? Como si puedes explicar un poco de cómo es, cómo es que ellos como estudiantes en Colorado son conectados con lo que está pasando en Putumayo. Con la droga, la guerra con el droga.
Bueno, como estudiantes y nacionales estadounidenses, es apoyar a estas comunidades de Colombia, del sur de Colombia, Cauca, Nariño, Putumayo, mediante la presión, el diálogo con sus senadores, con sus congresistas, para que todos los recursos de Plan Colombia no se vayan a esa parte militar, sino que realmente cada vez sea más fuerte el componente social que brinde unas alternativas diferentes a la producción de hoja de coca y su transformación, alternativas económicas que permitan vivir dignamente a las comunidades, respetando su cultura y sus derechos.
Well, so you guys are linked both as students and as United States citizens. So in order to support the communities here in Colombia, in Nariño, in Putumayo, and really like in all of the country, you can put pressure on your congressman and try and create a dialogue with your representative. to change the way that resources are being given to flank Colombia. So you can try and change it from going instead of to war to focus on the social component, which would be the alternative option for peasant farmers. To give them economic alternatives instead of growing cocoa, they can grow their own food crops and do so in a way that would respect their culture and their life.
Someone else
has
a question right there? Yeah.
Okay. ¿Me puedes decir cómo es ser mujer involucrada en la lucha? ¿Todavía hay impactos de machismo y cómo los combate? So I asked her.
Bueno, en este momento en Colombia, en estas zonas afectadas fuertemente por el cultivo o proceso de coca y por la militarización, es muy difícil porque los patrones patriarcales se refuerzan con la militarización. Hay comunidades donde los actores armados, tanto legales como ilegales, quieren controlar el cuerpo, el vestido, la expresión y las relaciones afectivas de las mujeres.
So at the moment, the affected zones by the zones affected by cocoa cultivation are very militarized, and it's hard because the patriarchal local bosses are resort automatically to militarization, which is a very masculine notion.
Yeah. So basically the patriarchal norms are reinforced by militarization in the area, and both legal and illegal actors want to control both the bodies, the clothing, and the lives of women.
Muchas mujeres han sido asesinadas en Colombia por los actores armados solo porque disculpan que la chica es novia o compañera de un actor armado contrario. Con esto se han asesinado, bueno, se habla, las cifras oficiales hablan de más de 10.000 mujeres. Sus casos, el 90%, 95% están en la impunidad. Y la disculpa de todos los actores armados es que la chica o la mujer tenía relaciones o vínculos afectivos con el actor armado contrario.
It says there are many women who are killed by armed actors just because the only excuse is that the woman or the girl was the girlfriend of an armed actor from a different group. There are over 10,000 cases in which women have been killed for that same reason. That they've had relations or even just links with somebody from a different armed group. And between 90% and 95% of those do not get solved. They go through with no justice.
Do you think or predict that the U.S. is going to respond to all of the resistance and your work and everything and change the policies that they've been implementing since they're failing currently?
Como ustedes en su organización.
No. por nuestro trabajo, no. Es apenas un granito de arena. Puede cambiar, puede hacerla más flexible por ustedes, los estadounidenses.
Short answer is no. This is not for the work that we do here. So we're just a small grain in all of this. So there the United States might change. It would be a lot more flexible depending on the desires of you guys as U.S. citizens, but not for people from out here. Good question.
I'm just gonna step in real quick just to double check. Carol, what time should we be wrapping up around?
Maybe about 5 or 10 more minutes, depending on Maria's time.
Okay, well, I think maybe we'll take one more question, and then we can maybe we'll wrap up.
Okay.
Ask the last question?
If the U.S. government or the Colombian government were to implement any kind of new strategies that didn't involve militarization and, I guess, like massive human rights violations, what would be like the time scale for that? Like, would that be like ideally? Would that be like in like the next decade? If, I don't know. Does that make sense?
Okay. Yeah. Si el gobierno de los Estados Unidos o de Colombia va a implementar alguna de esas nuevas estrategias, ¿cuándo sería que no involucra la militarización y los abusos de derechos humanos? ¿Cuándo sería? ¿Como en la próxima década o más adelante?
Yo creo que sería como
difícil de predecir cuándo. Inicialmente en 1998, cuando se empezó a hablar del Plan Colombia y finalmente se empieza a implementar en el 2000, se hablaba de 4 años solamente. Ya llevamos 12 años y todavía hay una continuidad de Plan Colombia.
Very difficult to say when. So in 1998, the politicians and policymakers started talking about Plan Colombia, and it finally got implemented in 2000. But it was only supposed to be a 4-year plan, and we're now on our 12th year. So we still continue with Plan Colombia, and yeah, it's difficult to get some sort of time frame.
En el año 2000, el Plan Colombia una propuesta conjunta del gobierno de Estados Unidos y de Colombia, que es un plan, algo que se centra solo en Putumayo. En noviembre de 2011, el gobierno de Colombia lo eleva a política de Estado, que enmarca todo el territorio nacional y ya no solamente con apoyo económico, militar de Estados Unidos, sino también con apoyo de Europa y de cooperación internacional.
So Plan Colombia was proposed in 2000, and it was a joint proposal by the United States government and the Colombian government. And it's proposed for the Department of Putumayo, which is in the south. That's like one state within the United States. And in November 2011, it became a nationwide policy. So it's now serving as like the something for the whole country with national implementation. And they've gotten military support, not any longer just from the United States, but also from Europe and wider international cooperation.
What was that policy? What was the policy that was implemented?
¿Y cómo se llama la política de 2011?
From Putumayo.
¿Es a nivel nacional?
It's just in Putumayo, that's Plan Colombia.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Now you're saying it's in the whole country. Oh.
Yes, now it's now countrywide.
A nivel nacional se llama Política Nacional de Consolidación y Reconstrucción Territorial.
And so the nationwide policy is called the National Policy for Consolidation and Reconstruction of Territories.
Yeah. Okay, I think we also wanted in each one of these presentations that we are organizing or facilitating the connection between U.S. citizens and leaders of organizations and social movements in Colombia. We always are kind of hoping that this is the end of it. For the Social Reconciliation and Expertise, one of the main reasons that we think is a really good idea is that we hope that by connecting people in Colombia with audiences in the States, a better understanding and more involvement is generated on the part of U.S. citizens in some of the things that Mario was talking about today. We don't have a one-click action for you. We've had lots of discussions in terms of what is actually the best thing to propose in terms of if you want to continue working with these issues or investigating and learning more about these issues in the States, what can you do? And so we don't have one of those simple things where you can a form where you fill out send your congressman. And eventually we think the best strategy is for people to become more involved in organized movements that have well-developed national strategies for to change U.S. policy towards drugs, especially the drug war, and especially the drug war as it's in Colombia and other countries. So, like I said before, we'll be sending you the links, the names of the organizations, and email afterwards. But some important ones, one for more information, more especially more in-depth information about this, is a Latin American working group. They are kind of like a think tanky type of organization that do a lot more, yeah, coalition, that do a lot of analysis of U.S. policy and its effects, especially in Latin America. Secondly, just a second.
I think it is it begins at back but on your year and at least in seven.
So where did you another important group that's working on the war on drugs in the United States, and a little bit different than the Latin American working group, is called the I hate when this happens. As in totally blank. The Drug Policy Alliance.
And the Institute for Policy Studies.
And the Institute for Policy Studies.
WOLA?
I'm sure. Yeah, WOLA. I'm sure, Carol, you have lots of ideas too. But today we wanted to highlight LOG and the Drug Policy Alliance. The Drug Policy Alliance is especially really like. I think it's a good group because they simultaneously are using lobby work, working on Capitol Hill, trying and doing a lot of analysis work on U.S. drug policy and bills that are coming to Congress. At the same time, organizing grassroots movement to try and affect and change this policy. So that's a little bit different than LOG, the Latin American Work Group, in that it's not just information. That's a group that's really moving and working on trying to change U.S. drug policy. And they're coming much from more point of view of the effects of the war on drugs in the United States, which we haven't even gotten into in terms of the effects on colored communities, how many people are in prison due to the war on drugs, all that kind of stuff. And then, of course, Witness for Peace is also... Yeah, go ahead, you can talk about what you're doing.
Okay, well, we got some other ideas for you guys. okay.
there's a ton of stuff you guys can do to take action on these issues. One is we're coming into April, and Whitman does a National Days of Action for Columbia. And so we're trying to get groups all throughout the United States to organize events. The theme this year is about displacement, which is, as Maria Victoria was talking about, it's incredibly tied to the drug war with fumigations and the inability of people to eat causes displacement or displacement. So you can get order free postcards to send to your congressmen and women about what's going on in Colombia. You can also, we're trying to get people to create 5,200 houses to represent the 5.2 million people who are displaced here in Colombia, and send those to, or take pictures or send them to Washington State to do like a public installation to talk to our government about what's happening so we can change our policies. On a different note, this is all happening at the same time as the Summit of the Americas, and so your monitoring of what's going on during that summit is really important. We also, both FOR and Witness for Peace, have delegations that come down here. So if you guys are interested in coming down, talking to more amazing people like Maria Victoria, hearing their stories, seeing what the land looks like and it's been communicated, check out our website and you can sign up for a delegation through that. And finally, we're about to launch a campaign with flower workers in May around Mother's Day. And so we're trying to get people to organize in high school, so if you guys are connected to your high school still. The women in the flower industry here, which 76% of the flowers get exported to the United States, and they work in really, really rough conditions. And so they just put out a documentary that's from the perspective of their kids and like what it's like to have their mothers, because the predominantly female workforce, go off to work in the flower industry. So we're trying to connect that to kids in schools in the United States. So if any of you are interested in helping us to organize events in high schools in the States, that would be awesome.
I would also add the Students for Sensible Drug Policy, which just opened up a new chapter at CU in the law school, which is right next door to our dorm right here.
Perfect.
Yeah. And I've also forwarded them the FOR newsletter that just came earlier this week, so they can sign up for that, and I'll do the same with Witness for Peace.
Thanks, Carol.
Yeah.
¿Tienes
algo que quieres ayudar o escribirnos?
Bueno, lo último, con Wola, CIP, Indepaz y Minga, venimos haciendo monitoreo ciudadano a la implementación de la política antidrogas en Colombia. Entonces, pues es más una invitación. Pueden visitar la página web www.cai.org para ver los adelantos de este monitoreo pues realizado con el apoyo del Centro FOR.
Okay. Yes, she wanted to add there a couple other ones. One Center for International Policy, or CIP, the Washington Office of Latin America. I'm sure Carol has a lot of these. Her organization, which is called MINGA, M-I-N-G-A, and another that's called INDEPAZ, INDEPAZ. I'll send all of these in an email to Carol in case these acronyms get a little lost. But these organizations have put together, they're all citizen monitoring organizations of the drug war and its impact here in Colombia. And she wants to invite you guys to visit their website, which is ccai.org. You can find their resources there with, and they all have the help of the War Foundation.
Muchas gracias,
María, por venir a nuestra clase y edificarnos sobre los temas en Colombia, y gracias por su trabajo. Bueno, thanks all of you guys. Good to see you again, Isaac. Thanks for coordinating, everybody.
Yeah.
Thank you guys very much for having us.
Coming to class. Thanks for coming.
Yeah.
We'll be in touch. Okay.
Thanks, Carol.
Bye. 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 Bye.
Gracias.